Friedrich Gottlieb Klopstock, Wikipedia Audio. Friedrich Gottlieb Klopstock, July 2, 1724 March 14, 1803 was a German poet. His best-known work is his epic poem Der Mesches. One of his major contributions to German literature was to open it up to exploration outside of French models. Klopstock was born at Kaidlinburg, the eldest son of a lawyer. Both in his birthplace and on the estate of Friedberg on the Saale, which his father later rented, he spent a happy childhood. Having been given more attention to his physical than to his mental development, he grew up strong and healthy and was considered an excellent horseman. In his 13th year, he returned to Kaidlinburg and attended the gymnasium there, and in 1739 went on to the famous classical school named Skulpturda. Here he soon became adept in Greek and Latin versification, and wrote some meritorious idylls and odes in German. His original intention of making Henry the Fowler the hero of an epic was abandoned in favor of a religious epic, under the influence of Milton's Paradise Lost, with which he became acquainted through Bodmer's translation. While still at school, he had already drafted the plan of Der Mesches on which most of his fame rests. On September 21, 1745 he delivered, on quitting school, a remarkable departing oration on epic poetry Abschiedsred über die epische Poesie, Kultur und Literargeschicht Licher Lauderd, and next proceeded to Jena as a student of theology, where he drew up in prose the first three cantos of the Mesches. Finding life at that university not to his liking, he transferred in the spring of 1746 to Leipzig, where he joined a circle of young men of letters who contributed to the Bremer Beitrage. In this periodical the first three cantos of Der Mesches were published anonymously in hexameter verse in 1748. Biography. A new era in German literature had commenced, and the identity of the author soon became known. In Leipzig he also wrote a number of odes, the best known of which is An Mein Freunde, afterwards recast as Wingolf. He left the university in 1748 and became a private tutor in the family of a relative at Langens Alza, where unrequited love for a cousin disturbed his peace of mind. For that reason he gladly accepted in 1750 an invitation from Bodmer, the translator of Paradise Lost, to visit him in Zurich, where Klopstock was initially treated with every kindness and respect and rapidly recovered his spirits. Bodmer, however, was disappointed to find in the young poet of the Mesches a man of strong worldly interests, and a coolness sprang up between the two men. At this juncture Klopstock received from Frederick V of Denmark, on the recommendation of his minister Count von Bernstorff, an invitation to settle in Copenhagen with an annuity of 400 thalers, in the hope that he would complete Der Mesches there. The offer was accepted. K. Schmidt, Klopstock und seine Freunde, this is the basis for Klopstock and his friends. A series of familiar letters, written between the years 1750 and 1803, translated and introduced by Elizabeth Benger, C.A.H. Clodius, Klopstock's Nachlass, J.M. Lappenberg, Brief von UND and Klopstock. On his way to the Danish capital, Klopstock met in Hamburg the woman who later in 1754 became his wife, Margareta Mahler, the Sidley of his odes. She was the daughter of a Hamburg merchant and an enthusiastic admirer of his poetry. His happiness was short, as she died in 1758, leaving him broken-hearted. His grief at her loss finds pathetic expression in the 15th canto of the Meshes. The poet subsequently published his wife's writings, Hinterlassene Werke von Margarete Klopstock, which give evidence of a tender, sensitive and deeply religious spirit. See also Memoirs of Frederick and Margaret Klopstock and her correspondence with Samuel Richardson, published 1818. Klopstock now relapsed into melancholy, new ideas failed him, and his poetry became more introspective. He continued to live and work in Copenhagen, however, and next, following Heinrich Wilhelm von Gerstenberg, turned his attention to Northern mythology, which in his view should replace classical subjects in a new school of German poetry. In 1770, when King Christian VII dismissed Count Bernstorff from office, he retired with the latter to Hamburg but retained his pension, together with the rank of Councillor of Legation. In 1773 were published the last five cantos of the Meshes. In the following year he published a scheme for the regeneration of German letters, Die Gelehrten Republik. In 1775 he travelled south, and making the acquaintance of Goethe on the way, spent a year at the court of the Margrave of Baden at Karlsruhe. Thence, in 1776, with the title of Hofrat and a pension from the Margrave, which he retained along with that from the King of Denmark, he returned to Hamburg where he spent the remainder of his life. His latter years he passed, as had always been his inclination, in retirement, only occasionally relieved by socializing with his most intimate friends, occupied in philological studies and taking scant interest in the new developments in German literature. However, he was enthusiastic about the American War of Independence and the French Revolution. The French Republic sent him a diploma of honorary citizenship, but, horrified at the terrible scenes the revolution had enacted in the name of liberty, he returned it. At the age of 67 he undertook a second marriage, to Johanna Elizabeth von Wintham, a widow and a niece of his late wife, who for many years had been one of his most intimate friends. He died in Hamburg on March 14, 1803, mourned throughout Germany, and was buried with great ceremony next to his first wife in the churchyard of the village of Ottensen. The Meshes is the materialization of Klopstock's early years aspirations to become an epic poet. The leitmotif of the work is the redemption, with an epic treatment. He resorted to Christian mythology, trying to circumscribing the matter to the dogmas of the Church. Early life. Milton's Paradise Lost was one of the models Klopstock had in mind in giving form his poem. The poem took 25 years to complete. The work aroused intense public enthusiasm in its commencement. It has been translated into 17 languages, and led to numerous imitations. In his odes, Klopstock had more scope for his peculiar talent. Some have Nordic mythological inspiration, while others are of religious theme. Among the most celebrated and translated are Infanni, Der Zürcher See, Die Tote Clarissa, and Sidlei, Die Beiden Musen, Der Rheinwein, Die Frühen Gräber, Mein Vaterland. His religious odes mostly take the form of hymns, of which the most beautiful is Die Frühlingsfeier. His dramas, in some of which, notably Hermanns Schlacht and Hermann und die Fürsten, he celebrated the deeds of the ancient German hero Arminius, and in others, Der Tod Adams and Salomo, took his materials from the Old Testament, also represent an important part of his body of work. he immortalized his 1750s visit at the Swiss O Peninsula in his Ode an den Zürich See. It has been said that Klopstock's hymn Die Auferstehung at the funeral of Hans von Bülow in 1894 gave Gustav Mahler the inspiration for the final movement of his Second Symphony. Mahler incorporated the hymn with extra verses he wrote himself to bring a personal resolution to this work. In addition to Die Gelehrtenrepublik, he was also the author of Fragment über Sprache und Dichtkunst in Grammatische Gespräche, works in which he made important contributions to philology and to the history of German poetry. As it was common in his literary age, Klopstock kept an abundant correspondence with his contemporaries, friends, and colleges, and this has been published in diverse collections. Some of them are listed below. Denmark and Germany. Depression and Meshes. Klopstock's Werke first appeared in 7 quarto volumes. At the same time, a more complete edition in 12 octavo volumes was published, to which 6 additional volumes were added in 1830. Other 19th century editions were published in 1844, 1845, 1854, 1855, 1879, 1884, and 1893. A critical edition of the Odes was published by F. Munker and J. Powell in 1889, a commentary on these by H. Duntzer. Last year's works. Der Meshes. Odes and Dramas. Prose. Goethe in his autobiography recorded his personal impression of Klopstock. He was of small stature, but well built. His manners were grave and decorous, but free from pedantry. His address was intelligent and pleasing. On the whole, one might have taken him for a diplomatist. He carried himself with the self-conscious dignity of a person who has a great moral mission to fulfill. He conversed with facility on various subjects, but rather avoided speaking of poetry and literary matters. Klopstock's enrichment of poetic vocabulary and attention to prosody did great service to the poets who immediately followed him. In freeing German poetry from its exclusive interest in Alexandrian verse, he became the founder of a new era in German literature, so that Schiller and Goethe were artistically indebted to him. Correspondence. Editions. Goethe's description. Legacy. Notes.